Hello, everyone, and welcome to tonight's Live with Bucky Live. Today, we'll be talking about the learning and affinity communities that we offer in the UW-Madison University residence halls. We'll have staff available via webcam and text answering questions and explaining how our learning and affinity communities can give new students a head start here at UW-Madison. Watch a replay of this live stream after it's over or view any of our other Live with Bucky Live sessions at go.wisc.edu/livewithbuckylive. Our next Live with Bucky Live will be next Tuesday, April 26th at 5:30 p.m. And we'll be talking all about preferences, contracts, and roommates in detail in advance of the May 2nd contract deadline. Before we get started today, I'll start by introducing myself and having the panelists introduce themselves. So my name is Susie Dowd, and I'm currently a senior here at UW-Madison studying marketing, and I'm a student housing ambassador with University Housing. And I'll pass it over to Cindy to introduce herself.
Thank you, Susie. Thanks everyone for joining us tonight. My name is Cindy Holtzman. I'm an associate director with the Residence Life Department at University Housing. And my role is to oversee these learning communities that we're going to be talking all about tonight. And I'm going to turn it over to my colleague, Alyssa.
Hi, everyone. My name is Alyssa Lamberton. I am an assignment coordinator with University Housing. So I work specifically with the assignments, contracting process, everything you're doing in your portal for signing up for housing. And I will pass along to Courtney next.
Thanks, Alyssa. Hi, everyone. My name is Courtney Lohman. I'm one of the Residence Life Coordinators in Woody Hall. Residence Life Coordinators, where we live in the building and we're there to help you with any problems that you might have and also do a lot of fun programming. But I also supervise the House Fellows in the Multicultural Learning Community and in Essence, which is our Black Affinity Community. And now pass it off to Jack.
Hi, everyone. My name is Jack Muirhead, and I'm a sophomore studying accounting and finance. My position is I am a peer mentor with the Bradley Learning Community. Now, without further ado, I'll pass it off to Amanda.
Hi, everyone. My name is Amanda, and I'm currently a business student studying accounting. I'm currently a freshman living in the startup community for entrepreneurship, and I'll pass it off to Kat.
Hi, everyone. I'm Kat Saavedra. I am a junior studying elementary education, and I lived in Chadbourne Residential Hall, and I actually work at Chadbourne as a lead peer mentor currently for the first year seminar course. And I'm going to pass it off to Cindy now.
All right. Thank you, panelists, for introducing yourselves. These are the friendly faces that we'll have live with us tonight. And to get things started, we're going to show a learning community video.
It really is a community because we live together, we go to events together. You walk to seminar with a group of friends, you walk back, you have dinner with them.
Whatever you are, wherever you come from, everyone is just accepted and you feel the love. Everyone's brand new, you're not the only one, don't feel alone. You're gonna find someone that you like, even if it's in class, in your dorm or not. And learning communities make that job a little bit easier.
It's just a great way for you to just skip those first steps that usually are the most scared ones. I learned a lot just sitting at the den, studying with my friends, stuff that I haven't learned in the lecture when I should have.
Don't worry if you have no idea or what you're gonna do. Think about what you're interested in, and that's where you can pick like a learning community based on that. And that's when you start to see more opportunities related to that.
We're all so close. We can talk about anything. We hang out. We have like a lot of events that we go to. It's just like a lot of fun.
They were always there to help me with any problem I had.
I'm friends with basically everyone on my floor, and I think that really helps because coming from Hong Kong, coming so far away, but when I got to Bradley, it felt like home right away, and that was really comforting.
I got to come to school and unpack and go to this programming room that was full of potatoes. And then I went up a floor and there was literally a full greenhouse full of plants and things growing.
You have the opportunity to work with faculty and also upperclassmen, which is really helpful in like learning what their experiences were and learning the ropes, figuring out how to be a college student.
Freshman year has a lot of information and a lot of things that they throw at you, and that can be pretty overwhelming. So I would definitely, for incoming students, advise over the summer, take some time to look at what's going on your freshman year and think about, okay, what do I think I'm really interested in?
It's the best decision I've ever made because you're making a big university smaller and more intimate.
And now we're going to pass it over to Cindy to tell us a little bit more about learning communities.
Thank you, Susie. So tonight we really want to focus on explaining to you what are these residential learning communities and affinity communities that are one option that you have available to you in the residence halls for next year. So as you kind of got the sense of from the video we just watched, so the learning communities bring together faculty and staff and students around a theme. We have 11 different learning communities, and the themes really range from things like sustainability to creative arts to multiculturalism in the US, entrepreneurship, global affairs. You can see the list there in front of you on the screen, and of course you can check that out on our website at any time. And that theme forms the basis for a unique seminar class that's only offered to learning community students, as well as a wide variety of extracurricular activities that are exclusive to those learning community students. And as you saw in the video, you heard a lot of those students talking about friendships, community. These programs are a living and learning community. So you live right on a floor, a wing. For some of the programs, it's the entire building of a residence hall. And part of the benefit of the community is that sense of community, the strong peer relationships, friendships that develop from living with people who have shared interests and experiences. Kat lived in the Chadbourn Residential College and now works there. Kat, can you tell us a little bit about a few of the unique activities that CRC students can participate in?
Of course. Chadbourn is very unique in the fact that it's a building-wide learning community and it's focused on liberal arts. So you have a very academic side, which you have cross-career advising, and you have even the writing center. But we also have very fun staple events like the CRC Olympics and even ski trips, as well as just like discussion and community forums. For example, this Monday we'll be hosting an event geared towards first years to like learn things that they should know about Ukraine during this time. And we actually were able to get 8 instructors and professors, and it's going to be hosted by honor students. So it has a lot of like opportunities to do both academic things, but also really fun things, I would say.
Thank you. And then in addition to these fun things, the fun extracurricular activities, the learning communities allow students to interact with faculty outside of the lecture halls, which really helps them develop valuable mentoring relationships and helps students plug in more quickly to the many academic and social opportunities available on campus. You know, there's so many wonderful resources on this large campus and so many amazing faculty. And it is a big place, and getting connected can sometimes be a little difficult to figure out in your first year. And that's one of the real values of the learning community. Jack lived and now works in the Bradley Learning Community. That program has more than 15 faculty fellows from all over campus each year that help teach the seminar class and interact with students. Jack, can you tell us a little bit about some of the interactions you had with faculty and how you think that assisted you in your first year on campus?
Of course, yeah. So for any learning community, but especially with Bradley, you're going to get the most faculty interactions through your seminar class. And Sari briefly touched on this, but the seminar classes are usually a group of like 10 to 15 students, a faculty fellow, and then a student advisor like myself. And these are a great opportunity to build community and just focus on something that you're interested in. Quick example of something that has helped me with dealing with a faculty fellow is I was initially a pre-business student. And so during my second semester freshman year, I had to go through the business application process. And so my faculty fellow played a really large role in helping prepare me by reviewing my essays, reviewing my resume. She was just super instrumental in helping that be a smooth process and eventually be a successful one. And so that's just one of the many examples of how interacting with a faculty fellow can really help progress you academically. But there's also various ways through socially, and it just really can help build a sense of community here on campus by interacting with these faculty fellows.
And if you check out the Bradley page, you can look at the list of all the faculty fellows and see. So it's sponsored by the College of Letters and Science, which is the biggest college on campus. But the faculty pull from all over the place, right? Psychology, statistics, kinesiology. We have engineering faculty some years. So there's really a wide variety of people involved from across campus. So lots of times students will wonder, well, I'm X major, what learning community should I be in? And does it have to be a particular learning community, or do I have to be a particular major? I really encourage you to not think about major in particular. This is really more about interests. What things do you like doing? What are you interested in? What kind of clubs have you joined in high school? What kind of summer camps have you explored? And how might that relate to one of the communities that we offer? Students often change their majors. Students might still be exploring majors. So we don't confine you to just, you know, one particular major in one particular learning community. For example, in the studio, which is the creative arts learning community, some of those students are arts majors. Some of them are going to go on to careers that are not related to art, but they have a passion for the arts and they want to stay connected to that throughout their time at the university. And these programs can help you explore a wide variety of majors that maybe you're not even aware of. There's hundreds of majors on campus, so there might be a way to turn your passion into a major and a career path that you're not aware of. So that is one way that these learning communities can help support you. Amanda lives in the startup learning community in Celery Hall, which is focused on entrepreneurship. Amanda, will you tell us a little bit about some of the unique people or resources or programs that you've discovered through your involvement at Startup this year?
Of course. Definitely living in Startup, I'm definitely surrounded by a lot of people who are of different majors, such as engineering, comm sci majors, communication majors. And I think it's very cool to be surrounded by people, especially as a business major, that don't have the same interests as me, but even though we're all placed together, we all have some sort of interest in entrepreneurship, or maybe like you're just slightly interested in entrepreneurship. There's plenty of resources through seminar that especially John, like our instructor, like has people come in, people talk about their businesses, and we're able to have contact information so that we can reach out, build, maybe think about if we want to become an entrepreneurship or have those connections for the future. And I think those are incredible resources, since we also have like grants that allow us to explore those opportunities further, such as the Dream Big grant. And I particularly love to decorate, so I would apply for decorating grants and I would be able to get that. And it's so many things that like you can go for all into one, and it doesn't necessarily have to be like stuck to one major. So I think that's so cool.
Yeah, thanks for mentioning that Dream Big grant. That is definitely another benefit of a number of these learning communities. We either are able to offer grants for things like that, or maybe study abroad or certain research with a faculty member, or we just know where those grants and funding resources are on campus, and we really help you get connected with those. So sometimes students are wondering, you know, am I going to have time for this? The first year of college sounds really busy. I'm going to have all my classes. I don't know. Is this too much to take on? Your level of involvement in the learning communities is really up to you. So we highly recommend this seminar class that we're talking about. Each of the learning communities has their own unique seminar class. We really do recommend that, because that's going to be the best way to get all the benefits of the learning community and to interact with the faculty, to interact with the peer mentors, and just to really understand what the theme of the learning community is all about. But those are courses that count towards your eventual graduation from UW-Madison. So they'll be part of your regular course schedule, and they fit in with pretty much any major. And then your participation in extracurricular activities is always up to you. And of course, we recognize that students have midterms and final exams, and we're planning activities appropriately throughout the course of the semester. So for less than $1 a day, the learning communities are really a significant return on your investment in terms of getting you off to a good start in your first year and are a nationally recognized high impact practice on campus. So if this sounds interesting to you, you need to return your housing contract by May 2nd. And you need to prioritize your learning community choices over your hall choices. So when you go into the My Housing portal, we ask you to list out which learning communities you might be interested in. And then we ask you if you want to prioritize learning communities or traditional residence halls. So you got to let us know that you want your learning communities first. Now, another option that we have is something called affinity communities, and I'm going to turn it over to my colleague, Courtney, to talk a little bit more about some of those.
Thanks, Cindy. So Cindy just talked to you a little bit about learning communities, so I'm going to talk to you a little bit about affinity communities. So in addition to learning communities, we have these affinity spaces, which are also living options in university housing. These communities bring together people with shared backgrounds or interests, or affinities, without kind of the academic element of learning communities. So kind of the goal of these communities is to allow students to foster a sense of belonging with students that have similar experiences or similar identities to them. So we're gonna highlight our two affinity communities. So one is Essence, which is the Black Affinity Living Experience. So the goal of Essence is to provide a living experience focused for students who identify as Black and or African American. So really the goal of Essence is to provide students a space to foster a sense of belonging, to connect through shared experiences, but also have a space where they can feel like they could be their authentic selves. So it's really just a space for if you self-identify as Black or African American to be surrounded by other students who share that identity as well. Our other affinity space is gender inclusive community. We do have some gender inclusive spaces across campus, but this is a very like specific community similar to Essence, but it's mostly for students who identify as transgender or gender non-conforming, non-binary, or students who identify within the LGBTQ plus community and or allies. And they can select this housing assignment so that they can have like an inclusive, safe and comfortable living experience. And this specific community is located in Lowell, but like I said, we do have other kind of gender inclusive options on campus too. But if you're interested in joining an affinity space or a learning community, they're kind of a similar process. You're just gonna wanna make sure that you state that you wanna live and prioritize your learning community in your housing contract by May 2nd. And then I'm gonna pass it back to Susie.
All right. Thank you, everyone, for sharing that wonderful information on the learning and affinity communities. And now we're going to get started with our live Q&A portion. So the first question we're going to start with is from Derek G. And this one's going to be for Alyssa. Does choosing a preferred roommate lower your chances of getting into a learning community?
Yeah, good question. So how the housing assignments work is we do operate on a lottery system. And so that means regardless if you submit it on your first day or the last day, you could end up in any residence hall or learning community on campus. So when roommates come into play here, we will always honor a roommate preference over your hall preferences. So if it comes down to you either can get your top choice hall or learning community, or you can be placed with your roommate, we're going to make sure you stay with your roommate. So yes, so having a preferred roommate does lower your chances of being placed in one of the residence hall on your preference list. However, having a random roommate does not guarantee that you would be placed in a hall or learning community on your preference list either. So it is all very, very dependent on how many other students preference that same community and how many spaces we have available there.
Great, thank you, Alyssa. And now we'll move to a question from Alia R. So the question is, what's the best way to pick a community? Seems like a daunting decision, and that it does. And we can pass this one to Cindy or perhaps one of the learning community students to share their experience and how they picked their hall.
Yeah, I would love to let the students talk about their experience more recently and how they picked. And what advice I would give you is really explore all the options, really look through all these learning communities, read through some of the pages, see some of the things that we're doing there. Is that interesting to you? if not, look around the rest of campus too and sort of check out a map, look at, you know, the different residence hall sizes. And I think really I would encourage you to think about what the community feel is going to be like as much as you're thinking about, you know, who's my roommate going to be. If you're going to go for a random roommate, many students do that every year and it works out just great. And the other thing I would say is don't pick it based on where you think your classes are going to be. Your classes are going to be everywhere. You're a first year student. You're going to have to take some English and some math and some chemistry. You're going to be going everywhere. So that's definitely not the reason to pick it. I'm going to turn it over to Amanda to talk about why she chose startup.
Hi. So I chose startup because I wanted to be surrounded by people that had different majors from me. And I really wanted to be submerged. And I didn't necessarily go into it thinking that I was going to be like an entrepreneur. I had some sort of interest. So I would definitely pick a community based on like some sort of interest and try to completely submerge yourself. Because even if you don't end up being like an entrepreneur in my case, or end up doing what they want you to do, or like that's what it's called, it definitely gives you a lot of benefits of like not even just being there, just meeting new people and getting those resources as well.
And Jack, did you want to share a story too about your decision-making process?
Yeah, I can talk briefly about it as well. So I lived in Bradley my freshman year. And I think the reason I ended up picking Bradley was because I wasn't drawn to any of the more specific learning communities. Like you have the bio house and the entrepreneurship, and none of those really stood out to me, but I knew I wanted to be a part of a learning community. And that's where I kind of ended up with Bradley, was the fact that it was almost like a build your own adventure. You got to pick what you wanted to do. And the peer mentors and the house fellows really just wanted to make your first year there successful. And that really spoke to me. So I wanted to be in a learning community that was there, but also maybe not super focused on one specific thing, more just a general kind of community to build on. Also, the Bradley Learning Community is the only learning community that can say it's all freshmen. So that was another big part for me. It's the only dorm on campus and the only learning community that is solely all freshmen. So that was something else that kind of drew me to Bradley as well.
Yes, thank you all for your responses there. And definitely recommend you viewers check out our website and check out the learning community page to explore those learning communities and see, you know, what speaks most to you. All right, so next question is going to be from Gabriel B. Does a freshman have to join a learning community? And we can toss this one over to Alyssa, maybe to clarify a little bit about the learning community and preference process.
Yeah, so all first-year students who are going through that application process and completing a housing contract, they are required to list preferences for a learning community, but not all students will be placed in one. So all students are required to list at least 2 to 5 learning communities, and then 8 residence hall preferences. So required to list that, but if you are more interested in the halls, you would indicate that on the next page. We do have a question that asks which one you're more interested in. So be sure to answer that question because that helps us kind of determine what you're most interested in. So you don't have to, but it is still possible, even if you did not preference it, is still possible for you to be placed in a learning community. And so if you are placed in that learning community, you are automatically taking part in it. But again, your level of participation is entirely up to you, and kind of what you get out of it is what you also put into it.
Yes, great. Thank you. And just another reminder here that all of your preferences are due by May 2nd. So that's the big date. And then the next question from Ben S. How many students apply for Chadbourne and how many spaces are available in a typical year? And we'll bring Alyssa back for this one, another assignments related question.
Yeah. So Chadbourne Hall has about 600 or so spaces. So we do see a very small number of returning students that choose to stay in Chadbourne for their second or third year. But it's a pretty small population. So the large majority are going to be incoming first year students. And so typically about 600 spaces. We don't have an exact number of how many listed as a preference. That does change drastically from year to year. Because we house primarily first year students, our incoming first year class really varies quite a lot by what they're preferencing and what they're interested in. So we do see preferences for all of our different learning communities, but each year it's going to kind of depend on what each class is more interested in.
Yes, great. Thank you, Alyssa. And so another question here Are we allowed to choose multiple learning communities if we're unsure about which specific one we want? So we kind of touched on this, Alyssa did. So all first-year students are required to list at least two learning community preferences, but can list up to five. And then you can choose if you want to place your learning community preferences above your halls or vice versa, halls above the learning communities. And we can move on to another question from Nathan L. Are there options to unenroll in a learning community? Maybe we can have Cindy talk about this one if students have issues with that or something along those lines.
So if you are part of a learning community, it's also based on where you live, right? So it really goes hand in hand. It's your room assignment and it's everything in that community and the staff members that are living and working in that community with you. And then the additional, you know, opportunities that are, of course, your choice to participate in the course or the extracurricular activities. The only way to really unenroll, if you will, is to move your room assignment and to move from where you're located in that learning community to a different residence hall. That can be very difficult because we are full of first year students. And so you'd be really waiting for a space in a different hall to open up. That sometimes can occur in between the semesters, but it's certainly not a guarantee. So it can be usually students who start in the learning community stay there for the whole year. Of course, your participation is up to you. And I don't hear we have very positive feedback from students who are excited about the things that they're doing in the learning community. And they understand that there are things that they can choose to participate in and things that they may not have the time or the interest in.
Yeah, great. So, you know, again, you can really choose your level of involvement, and they're a great way to make a large campus smaller and start building a strong sense of community from day one. Next question here from Kimberly. Is the WISE learning community a floor in Waters or the whole building? And maybe Alyssa can take this one.
Yeah, good question. So, and I can address this for all of our learning communities as well. So some of our communities are going to be the entire hall. And so those examples would be Bradley Learning Community and then Chadbourne Residential College. For all of our other learning communities, they're going to be a section or a floor or a certain portion of the building. So for WISE specifically, we actually have WISE located in three different houses within Waters Hall. So if you haven't heard of them yet, get used to talking about houses. At UW-Madison, in our residence halls, we have houses that are kind of sections of the residence hall. So in some buildings, it's the whole floor. It's a way to just kind of break up the building into different areas that our house fellows, which people typically know as RAs, oversee those areas. So in Waters, WISE is located in Kellogg, Pearson, and Troxel houses. And so it makes up a really good chunk of it. So they're not necessarily just on one floor, but it is one specific section of that building.
Awesome. Thank you. And so now we can address a few additional questions here. So just to kind of, you know, start to wrap things up, why should first year students strongly consider joining a learning community? Maybe Cindy can touch on those benefits again.
Yeah, thanks for that. I think the main reasons you would want to join a learning community is because it's going to get you quickly connected with all of the great resources that UW-Madison has to offer. You're going to get connected with faculty who can help mentor you and guide you through things, as Jack was saying, guiding you through the School of Business, you know, applications, as well as connecting you to, you know, internships, research jobs, lab jobs on campus. The community building happens really quickly in these places because of the additional activities and the additional time that people are spending together. And I love that there's one student in the video who says, you know, you're making a large campus feel smaller and more intimate, but you're still right here in the in the heart of a large campus with all of the benefits that a large campus has to offer.
Yes, great. Thank you. And another question here from Sylvia B. What's the difference between Chadbourne and Bradley? And we can have Jack answer that one.
Yeah, so really the main difference between, there's a couple of differences. First is I'm just going to say location. Location, Chadbourne is more in the center of campus. It's on what I would call the southeast side. So you're going to be more by like the Cole Center, if that rings true to anybody. While Bradley is on Lakeshore. So you're going to be right up against the lake, much more close to like areas like DeJope and Camp Randall, if that helps. So those are the first one is the difference in location. The second would be the difference in size. As we briefly mentioned, Chadbourne is about 600 residents, while Bradley is much smaller, about 400. So you're going to see a difference in size in the building as well, or the amount of residents. And then the other thing that I'd say is that Bradley is more focused on how do we make your first year here at UW super successful, while Chadbourne is more focused on kind of how can we explore your learning options and how can we give you a better understanding of various topics going on. I know that, as they briefly mentioned before, they're going to have like a large community discussion based on Ukraine. That's more what Chadbourne is focused on. Something that is going on in Bradley right now was kind of going through planning your schedule for next year and how you're going to pick your classes and what's the best way to do that. So there's a couple different aspects to Bradley and Chadbourne. They're both very still freeform in the idea of it's almost like a build your own adventure, but really it's the size, the location, and then some of the areas that that Bradley and Chadbourne cover that are a little bit different between the two halls.
Yeah, thank you, Jack, for detailing that difference. And again, definitely check out our website. You can check out both of those pages and compare them that way. And then another question here from Sherry G. Could an engineering major live in the studio learning community? Cindy, could you answer that one for us?
Absolutely, they could. So again, as we were sharing in the beginning, it's really not about major. It's about interest and passion. And I think engineering majors have a pretty high rate of participation in general throughout our learning communities, and they find a home in a lot of different places. So studio can be interesting because there's a lot about creativity. So it's not just about getting better at your music or getting better at your dance or getting better at your visual out. There's a lot of emphasis just about creativity and the creative process and design. So there's a lot of elements there that an engineer, depending on how you're going to focus your engineering degree, there's a lot of things that you can build on there at the studio for sure. Some other great options for engineers, just to give you some other things to look at, is certainly biohouse. If you're interested in any kind of biomedical engineering, greenhouse is quite popular for anybody that's thinking about like applying their engineering degree to any element of environment, camp, you know, climate change, sustainability, anything like that. Startup is pretty popular with a lot of engineers too, because a lot of engineers think that maybe they would want to get involved in kind of, you know, a startup business at some point. And then there's a lot of engineering students who always find a home at Chadbourne, I think just because it's one of the larger communities, everybody is welcome there. It's conveniently located to everything that the engineering students are participating in.
Great, thank you for all that information. And just want to reiterate, the learning communities are more interest-based than they are major-based. And now we have a question for Jack, Amanda, and Kat. Could each of you share a memory or a positive experience or a good thing that they've gotten out of your specific learning community?
Hi, definitely. I really love attending my community events, especially community dinners. My community in particular is really close. I know everyone on my floor. And I think it's just so cool to like connect with many different people and learn about what they do. And we also have speakers that come in. So I definitely miss and love having those dinners.
All right, Kat, do you want to share an experience next?
Yeah, of course. So as I said, I'm a lead peer mentor in Chadbourne right now. And I think one of the best things that has let me, like my favorite memory from Chadbourne has actually been kind of being a mentee at one point and feeling very like heard and feeling very validated in my experience. And then later becoming a peer mentor and then a lead peer mentor and actually getting to do that for someone else, like another freshman. So that sense of community has always been my favorite part about being in a learning community.
Yeah, I'd say my favorite memory would be come from this year, and it would be that we had an Oreo taste testing session. So just as a team bonding and kind of a community building experience, we got like 8 different Oreo flavors and just ate Oreos for 2 hours. That's all we did. We just like hung out and ate Oreos, and it was a blast. So it was just a ton of fun just to hang out with residents, eat good food, and just kind of enjoy each other's company. And so that's probably one of my favorite moments and something I hope they will bring into the next year and years to continue.
All right. Thank you all for sharing those experiences. They definitely sound, you know, like something I'm interested or I would be interested in being a part of. And that ends our live Q&A session. So thank you all so much for your questions. And that's going to wrap up our session today. If you have any more questions that you're curious about, please feel free to reach out to us through our contact us form at go.wisc.edu/housing-connect. And one date that you're all going to want to remember, May 2nd, this is the date that all of your preferences are due in MyUW Housing. And this includes roommates, hall and learning community preferences, as well as your advanced payment. And you can edit those preferences through that May 2nd date. And our next Live with Bucky Live will be next Tuesday, April 26th at 5:30 p.m. And we'll be talking about preferences, contracts and roommates, and all of that stuff before the May 2nd contract deadline. Thanks again for joining us, and we look forward to welcoming you to campus soon. Hope you all have a great night, and hope to see you next week.